Welcome to M Coding. I'm James Murphy. Let's talk about asynchronous programming in Python. I'll show you the basic async await syntax, as well as the built-in async.io library. Then we'll get into the good stuff, writing a web crawler. All right, let's jump into the code. I claim that you already understand asynchronous programming. Suppose today we've got three things we need to do. We're waiting on our Amazon package to arrive, we need to do our laundry, and we're also baking a cake. So do we just loop over those tasks and do them one after another? According to this, first we should spend all day waiting for our package to arrive. Only after it arrives should we start our laundry. And then we should sit and wait for our laundry to finish. After our laundry finishes, we start baking the cake and watch it in the oven until it's done. Nothing wrong with a lazy Saturday if that's the way that you want to do things. But at the very least, you probably recognize that things could be done more efficiently. Why not just order your package, then immediately put your laundry in, then immediately put the cake in? All you're doing is waiting, why not just wait for all three at the same time? Well, that's exactly the fundamental idea behind asynchronous programming. Just like in real life, there are some tasks in programming that are primarily made up of waiting for something to finish happening. These would typically be things like waiting on a file to finish writing to disk or waiting on packets from the network. It doesn't matter whether you're using Python or C, you can't make Facebook.com respond any faster, you just have to wait. And that's what async.io is all about. If you're waiting on a bunch of things, you can wait on all of them at the same time. Alright, so how do we do it in Python? Take any function that might need to wait on something and slap an async on there. For us, that's do work, and then we also have to mark main async because we want to do work in main. Do work and main are now coroutine functions. Unlike a normal function, when you call a coroutine function, it doesn't run the function. Instead, calling a coroutine function, an async def function, returns a coroutine, which you can think of as a very lightweight task. But the whole point of async is that we don't just want to immediately run every task that we come up with. So calling main down here just creates this main task, but it doesn't run it. Use async.io.run to start the very first coroutine. This starts the event loop, which is in charge of actually running our coroutines. Here we're calling do work, but remember, this just creates a coroutine, it doesn't run it. If we run the code, we see a warning saying that do work was never awaited. If you ever see this error, it probably means you forgot to write await. Await means wait here until this thing is done, pausing the current task if necessary. Async in Python is purely cooperative. You have to opt in and participate in order to see the gains. Here we're still using time.sleep, which is not an async function. Python will not pause and let someone else work just because this is sleeping. The only time you might pause and let something else run is when you await it. So replace time.sleep with async.io.sleep. And don't forget to await it. This is a kind of silly example because I could, of course, just delete the sleep altogether. But remember here, async.io is usually about waiting on I/O. So mentally replace this with writing to disk or waiting on packets from the network. Stay tuned for the web crawler to see a real use case. In any case, we run the thing again, and it still took 3 seconds. And that's because of these lines here. Remember, await means to wait here until this thing is done. But I don't want to wait here until this thing is done before I start the next one. I want to start all of them and then wait for them to finish. You accomplish that using tasks. Create task takes in a coroutine and wraps it in a task object and schedules that task on the event loop. But importantly, it does not await the task right then and there. This allows us to create and schedule multiple tasks before waiting on any of them. Then we can use async.io.wait to wait on all of them. And now when we run it, we see all three tasks are started immediately. Then a second later, they all finish, and it only took 1 second, not three, because we were waiting on all three tasks simultaneously. This is still just one Python process and one Python thread. We don't need multiple cores or threads to wait for time to pass. The package will arrive, the laundry will finish, and the cake will bake, all without any extra input from us, we just wait. If our coroutines returned any results, we could inspect the results like this. If there was an exception, it would be re-raised when we ask for the result. Wait returns done tasks, but also pending ones. This is because wait supports a timeout, and it's possible that not all the tasks are done by the time the timeout is over. But if you don't specify a timeout, pending should be empty. Another way to do basically the same thing is using async.io gather. This accumulates the results of the tasks in a list. It can even take coroutines directly, which is something that wait can't do. In that case, it'll automatically create tasks for them. You could catch any exceptions raised with a try catch around this line, or specify return exceptions equals true to just get the exceptions as elements of the results list. And in Python 3.11, there's yet a third way to do exactly the same thing. Just like a normal with statement can ensure that a file opened using open is automatically closed, this async with task group ensures that all of the created tasks are automatically awaited. I know this must be very jarring to have three different ways to do exactly the same thing. I can hear murmurs of the zen of Python even across the internet. But the reality of it is that asynchronous programming in Python was very much an afterthought. Like it or not, that's reality in Python, so we just have to deal with it. Just make sure to keep up to date with best practices. It's one of the most rapidly changing parts of Python with each new release. So enough with this syntax and this silly example where I could just delete this sleep statement. Let's get to the web crawler. Here's a basic but fully functional web crawler. It takes an asynchronous client. In this case, I'm using the HTTPX library. We take some initial URLs to start our crawl. Then this filter URL is just a function that we're going to use to filter out links that we don't want. And we'll take in the number of workers this crawler should use, which will determine the number of simultaneous connections it can use. And we'll put a limit on the total number of pages to crawl. 25 is a really small limit, but this is just for testing purposes. We save the client, save the set of starting URLs. We make a queue to hold the work that needs to be done. Scene will hold all the URLs we've seen before to prevent us from crawling the same one twice. And done will contain all the finished crawls that were successful. We store our filter function, number of workers, and the limit on how many crawls to do. Then we initialize total, which will keep track of how many crawls we've done. Everything is centered around this run function. It's an async function that will crawl until it's done. We start by putting our start URLs in the queue. This is done in this onFoundLinks function. Whenever we find some links, we compute which ones we haven't seen before, mark those as seen. You could save things to a database or file here, but we're not going to. Then for each new URL, we put it into our to-do queue. We do this in a separate function to respect our limits. Whenever we put something into the queue, we add one to the total. If we're beyond our limit, then we don't put anything more into the queue. An async queue has a pretty standard queue interface, the main methods being put and get. Of course, being an async queue, these are async functions. We didn't set a limit on how big our queue can be, but if we did, putting something into the queue might require waiting until something else has finished. Anyway, back to our run function. The effect of this is to put all of our starting URLs into the queue. Then we use a pretty common technique, which is creating a bunch of workers that all simultaneously wait for work from the queue. Each worker is just another coroutine, and we use create task to schedule this many workers. However, we don't wait on the workers. We await on what we actually care about, the queue. The queue contains all the work that needs to be done. Waiting for the queue to join is the same as waiting for all the tasks to be completed. As long as there's more tasks, we want to keep going. But as soon as there's no more work to do, then we can stop. In that case, we go through and cancel all the workers. Cancel is a method that's available on all coroutines that just raises a canceled error inside the coroutine. So what does each worker do? They just forever try to process one element in the queue until they're canceled. Processing an element is pretty straightforward. Get is also asynchronous, and we might have to wait in order to get work to do. If we do have to wait to get work, that means the queue is empty. But that's not the same as there being no work left to do. That's because the queue's join that we're waiting on doesn't go based off of the number of elements in the queue, but rather it goes off of whether the number of elements taken out of the queue is equal to the number of tasks that have been marked complete. So the general pattern is get work out of the queue, do the work, and then mark the work as complete. We use a try finally to ensure that the task is always marked done, no matter whether there was an exception or not. This is important because if we ever missed a task done, the queue would never join because it thinks that there's still work in flight. As far as actually doing the work, now we finally get to something that's specific to the crawler. This whole run worker queue stuff is a very common pattern, so the crawl is the first place that we actually do something specific to our crawler. We try to crawl the URL, and if anything goes wrong, we just pass. If you wanted to, this would be the place to add retry handling. Put the URL back into the queue and keep note of how many times you've tried. We're going for a more minimalistic approach. onto the crawl. I'm just outright sleeping for 0.1 seconds here. This would be a good place to do proper rate limiting. You want to make sure that you're not sending out too many simultaneous connections, both in total and per domain. Our number of workers limits the total number of connections, but we have nothing to limit the number of connections per domain. In any case, be nice, rate limit yourself. Oh, and if you forget to rate limit yourself, this is a great way to get yourself banned from all your favorite websites. Many websites will automatically ban your IP address if they detect too many connections too fast. After rate limiting, we use our asynchronous client to go out and get the URL. Once you've got the HTML, parse out the links, mark them as found, and then you're done with that URL. I left parse links as an async function, but really it's just totally synchronous code. All I do is create this URL parser, which is a custom subclass of the built-in HTML parser in Python. Let's take a look at the parser. Did you know Python has a built-in HTML parser? So please put away that attempt at using a regular expression. HTML is not a regular language. Regular expressions are not sufficient to parse HTML. All we do is override the handle start tag from the class. There are other ways to look for links, but we're essentially just looking for ahref tags. So if we see an a tag with an ahref attribute, then we go in and filter our URL. If it passes the filter, then we add it to our set of found links. Just a note on what this base thing is. When you click on a link, where it takes you depends on where you currently are. So the base is being used to track where we currently are. The filter URL function we're using for this crawler isn't very sophisticated. I wrote this URL filterer. It just takes allowed domains, schemes, and file types. Then to filter the URL, it parses where the link would go based off of the base, and if the scheme is bad, or if the domain is bad, or if the file type is bad, then we just return none. Otherwise, we return the normalized URL. You can really put in whatever you want here. Those are just a few things I came up with. And that's it for the crawl. We got the response, parsed the links, and then on found links, we'll add the new ones back into our queue. And then the worker will just get the next element and keep going. Eventually, we'll either crawl everything within our constraints or hit the limit on the number of crawls that we're willing to do. Either way, the queue will eventually empty, the to-do join will finish, and we'll cancel all the workers who would otherwise be stuck here waiting for more work. Then all that's left to do is try it. Let's make a URL filterer. I'm just going to use my own domain as the only allowed one, and I'll only search links with HTML, PHP, or no file extension. We use an async with to get a client for our crawl. Pass everything to the crawler with an initial URL of the root of my website, and then await the crawler's run method. At the end, we'll just print out the results. And there you go, it found all the pages on my website. Finally, a quick tip when you're debugging with coroutines, asyncio.run takes a debug flag. If you turn this on, things will be slower, but you'll get way better error messages. If you're looking to test your understanding, then try some of these exercises as homework. Thank you to Brilliant.org for sponsoring this video. Hone your algorithm skills with Brilliant's Algorithm Fundamentals course, where you can learn about classic searching and sorting algorithms, concepts like Big O notation, and the stable matching problem. Or branch out and find something new to fit your taste. Brilliant has thousands of interactive math, science, and computer science lessons to help you learn something new every single day. And there are more lessons on the way every month, so you're never going to run out. Visit brilliant.org/mcoding or click the link in the description to get started with your free 30-day trial today. And if you'd like, the first 200 of my viewers to sign up for Brilliant's annual premium subscription will get 20% off. That's brilliant.org/mcoding. As always, thank you for watching and thank you for making it to the end. Asynchronous programming is a huge topic, so let me know if there's anything you'd like me to cover. As always, thank you to my patrons and donors for supporting me. See you next time.